Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. This is Pursue 15H, which is erythrocytic diseases. We are streaming live from PGIMS Rohtak via Kolkata. We have a very interesting topic and a very famous person to speak on the topic. The topic of the day is folate, cobalamin, and megaloblastic anemia. And to talk on that, we have Dr. Nisha Marwa. She is an MD pathology from PGIMS Rohtak. Presently, she is a professor of pathology and the deputy dean at PGIMS Rohtak with 30 years of teaching experience and more than 180 publications in national and international peer-reviewed journals, multiple presentations in international and national conferences, guest speakers and chairperson in many national conferences, more than 20 theses to her name in which she has supervised observership in liver pathology at QE Hospital, Birmingham, UK in 2011-12. Before I ask Madam to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please do not share your screen. We are live on YouTube. So with that, ma'am, please share your screen and let us start. Thank you so much.
Good evening, all. Good evening, Dr. Nadeem. Thank you for such kind words. And I would like to thank you and Dr. Anita Tehlan for giving me this opportunity to share this platform and to be a part of this Pursue lecture, Pathology. Today we are going to talk about a very common and very important topic in hematology, that is megaloblastic anemia. Anemia is one of the most prevalent condition in our country with a prevalence rate of approximately 39%. Iron deficiency anemia is the most common type of anemia, but megaloblastic anemia is also very common, and it has got a varied presentation, varied etiology. So we are going to talk about all these aspects. I have tried to compile everything in one lecture. It is very vast, so I've tried to take the main points in the lecture. So we start. Is it okay now?
Absolutely fine, ma'am. Please start. Okay, and there's no time limit. You can go around, say, no issues.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Nadeem. So today we are going to talk about megaloblastic anemias, which are disorder of impaired DNA synthesis. When we talk about anemias, either we do the etiological classification or we do the morphological classification. Based on morphology, these anemias can be either microcytic anemias, normocytic anemias, or macrocytic anemias. Macrocytic anemias are when MCV is more than 100 femtoliters. These macrocytic anemias can either be macrocytic megaloblastic anemias or they can be non-megaloblastic anemias depending on the erythropoiesis in the bone marrow. Macrocytic non-megaloblastic anemias are due to varied etiology, commonly due to liver diseases, chronic alcoholism, in various hemoglobinopathies, thyroid disorders, myelodysplastic syndrome, anemias due to infiltration of bone marrow, due to hemolysis, various drugs, chronic obstructive airway diseases, vitamin C deficiency, and many other causes. Megaloblastic anemias, they have a distinctive cytological and functional abnormalities due to impaired synthesis of DNA. In PBF, we have macrocytic picture, but in bone marrow, we have characteristic megaloblastic erythropoiesis. These abnormal erythrocytes, erythroid cells, they were named as megaloblast firstly by Ehrlich in 1880. Common causes of megaloblastic anemias are due to deficiency of vitamin B12 and folic acid, but less commonly they can be due to acquired or congenital abnormalities in the metabolism of vitamin B12 or folic acid, and sometimes disorders which are not related to these two vitamins. But they are okay. So we were discussing about megaloblastic anemias. These anemias, they have distinctive cytological and functional abnormality due to impaired DNA synthesis. PBF shows macrocytic picture, bone marrow shows megaloblastic erythropoiesis, and this megaloblast name was given by Ehrlich in 1880. Causes of megaloblastic anemias are common causes due to deficiency of B12 and folic acid. Less commonly, they are due to acquired or congenital abnormality in the B12 folic acid metabolism, and disorders which are not related to these deficiencies, they directly impair the DNA synthesis, and we will talk about them later. B12 is a complex organometallic compound which is known as cobalamin. We have hydroxycobalamin, methylcobalamin, adenosylcobalamin. Methyl and adenosylcobalamin, they are the active forms, while the hydroxy is precursor of these two, and that is given in therapeutic doses. B12 is essential for two main reactions in the body in hematopoiesis, and secondly, to maintain the integrity of CNS system. Common sources of vitamin B12 are animal products and dairy products. Here we take second-hand sources. Primary sources are microbes, which are normal inhabitant in the GIT. They synthesize large amounts of B12 in large intestine. But since the absorption of B12 occurs in ileum, this B12, which is present in the large intestine, is not available to the body, and we are entirely dependent on the dietary sources. Rich sources are liver, kidney, muscle meat, and seafood. Dairy products, they also have good amount of B12, but vegetables, they do not contain B12 and poor source. B12 is absorbed in the body by two mechanisms, active and passive. About 75% of the absorption is by active absorption method. It is highly efficient, but is a slow process, taking at least 8 to 20 hours from ingestion to attaining the peak levels in the circulation. At one time, this is dependent on the intrinsic factor, which at one time can bind only to 1 to 2 micrograms, and more than that will be absorbed very slowly and poorly. During absorption, B12 in food, which is bound to certain binding proteins, it is taken inside the stomach. This is dissociated from the protein by the action of pepsin present in the gastric juices. Now, this dissociated vitamin B12 here, now it will bind to R binder proteins. These R binder proteins, they come from saliva. And now this complex will move to duodenum. Here, with the help of pancreatic proteases, they again dissociate the two. And now this will bind, vitamin B12 will bind to intrinsic factor. This intrinsic factor coming from parietal cells in the stomach. This complex is then taken into the ileum, terminal part of the ileum, where the tubulin receptors, they are present to bind the complex. And all these three will be taken inside the cell. Inside the cell, the receptor gets free and again moves to the surface of the mucosal cell. Intrinsic factor is degraded, and B12 is taken into the circulation with the help of transporting protein, that is transcobalamin 2. we have three major transporter proteins. Transcobalamin 1, which is also known as haptocorin. It is alpha globulin with molecular weight 60,000, but its primary function is storage, and approximately 80 to 90% of the B12 is bound to transcobalamin 1. However, this is not essential for transport, and its deficiency also does not lead to much clinical signs of vitamin B12 deficiency. The most important transporter protein is transcobalamin 2, which is beta globulin of molecular weight 38,000. This is essential for transport of cobalamin in the circulation from one organ to another and within the cell and outside the cell. Vitamin B12, approximately 10 to 15% is attached to transcobalamin 2, and this combination is known as holotranscobalamin. This has become very important because nowadays we are estimating the levels of holotranscobalamin. This is the biologically active fraction, and congenital deficiency of transcobalamin. Is it okay now?
Yeah, perfectly fine. Please go ahead. Thank you.
So we were talking about transcobalamin 2, which is a beta globulin weight 38,000. This is essential for transport of cobalamin from one organ to another. And this is attached to, when vitamin B12 gets attached to transcobalamin 2, this is referred to holotranscobalamin, which is the biologically active fraction. Congenital deficiency of transcobalamin 2 would result in severe megaloblastic anemia. Transcobalamin 3 binds only to a small fraction and is not very important. Passive mechanism is only up to 1% of the oral vitamin B12 can be absorbed this way. This is a poorly understood, less efficient pathway, but here the absorption is rapid. It occurs through diffusion from buccal, gastric, and jejunal mucosa. It operates when we give the pharmacological doses of vitamin B12. But the thing is, this is not dependent on intrinsic factor or the ileum. Most of the vitamin B12 is excreted through bile. It is, but 2/3 of this excreted is again reabsorbed via the enterohepatic circulation. Some part of it is lost in the desformated intestinal epithelial cells. Absorption also occurs at the level of kidney in the proximal convoluted tubules through the gamelin receptors. So most of the vitamin B12, which is excreting through the body, it is getting reabsorbed. That's why we have large stores in our body. It is stored mainly in liver. Body stores are 3 to 5 milligrams, while the daily requirement is 1 to 4 micrograms. And these stores, they are 1,000 times more than the daily requirement. So even if there is sudden stoppage, sudden cessation of B12 in food or like in gastrectomy, we have sufficient stores to last a couple of years before there is clinical symptoms of deficiency. Coming to the functions of vitamin B12, there are two main functions in biosynthesis of DNA and in maintenance of integrity of CNS system. In these two reactions, it acts as a coenzyme. There are two major reactions. One is homocysteine to methionine conversion. And during this conversion, methylcobalamin acts as a coenzyme. When homocysteine is being converted into methionine, this methyl tetrahydrofolate in the body, in the circulation, it gets converted into tetrahydrofolate. And this tetrahydrofolate is then converted into methylene tetrahydrofolate. This methylene tetrahydrofolate will be converted into methylene folate. And during this conversion, DUMP is converted into DTMP, which is an important factor in the DNA synthesis. So throughout this cycle, methylcobalamin is acting as a cofactor. And if we have deficiency of B12 or here, this reaction would not take place. And most of the methyl tetrahydrofolate, which is the non-functional form, would not be converted into the functional form. This theory is known as methyl tetrahydrofolate trap. And this explains the deficiency of B12. and its role in impairing DNA synthesis. Second important reaction is conversion of methylmalonyl coenzyme A to succinyl coenzyme A, and here the adenosyl cobalamin acts as a coenzyme. When there is deficiency of adenosyl cobalamin, this would not be converted and we will have increased levels of MMA and propionate in the body, which will then lead to synthesis of abnormal myelin lipids, degeneration of the myelin, and various neurological symptoms. So these two important reactions are conversion of homocysteine to methionine, and this reaction is important for the DNA synthesis, and conversion of MMA to succinyl coenzyme A, this reaction is important for the myelin synthesis. Coming to folic acid, this is a water-soluble vitamin which occurs in the form of folates, and in the nature, this is present in the form of polyglutamates. We have folic acid in wide variety of food in form of dark leafy vegetables, then nuts, liver and yeast. They are the richest sources for folic acid. But these sources, they are not consumed in routine. So routinely consuming sources are vegetables, grains, beans, certain citrus fruits. They are the rich sources. But in spite of having so many food which are rich in folic acid, we develop folic acid deficiency faster than the B12, because most of the folic acid is lost in storage, and also the method of cooking which we are using. When we cook the food in large amounts of water, most of the folic acid is lost. So in our Indian cooking scenario, where we are cooking, we are frying, we are heating again and again, most of the folic acid is lost and is not available. Absorption of folic acid is less complicated than B12. In the diet, folic acid is present in the form of polyglutamates. Within the intestine, by the action of intestinal conjugases, they are converted into monoglutamates, which is absorbed in duodenum and upper part of jejunum. Within the epithelial cells, it is converted into methyl tetrahydrofolate, which is the form which is taking part in the various reactions in the body. It is also released in portal circulation as methyl tetrahydrofolate and is transported either in the free form or weakly bound to the proteins. Stored in the liver, we have total body stores of 5 to 20 milligrams. Our daily requirement is 50 to 200 micrograms, and every day we are using 1 to 2% of the stored folic acid. So stored, they get exhausted sooner than the stores in B12 deficiency. And it takes a couple of months before the stores are exhausted if intake is completely stopped. Main function of folic acid, it acts as a middleman and in various body reactions for transferring one carbon unit from one compound to another compound. And this carbon unit is transferred in the form of methylene methyl or formyl groups. Two reactions which are common with vitamin B12 is conversion of DUMP to DTMP and homocysteine to methionine, where the methyl tetrahydrofolate takes part. Along with that, it helps in synthesis of purine. And there is another reaction, that is catabolism of histidine to glutamine. Here the intermediary product is formed, that is 4-aminoglutamic acid, and this intermediary product, it is then converted into glutamine, and it is here where we need the tetrahydrofolate. So whenever there is deficiency, this product would be present in higher concentration and it would be excreted in urine, and we can measure the excretion. Now with this background of normal B12 and folic acid, now we come to the deficiency states. Both of these vitamins, they have deficiency states, but there are certain difference in clinical presentation. While the B12 deficiency is mainly a deficiency in absorption, folic acid deficiency is mainly the deficiency in the dietary intake, that is at the level of decreased intake, while the B12, unless the person is strictly vegetarian and is on inadequate diet for a long duration, a decrease is not a common cause for vitamin B12 deficiency. It is mainly due to impaired absorption. This impaired absorption can be at the level of stomach, in like in old age group, when we are taking H2 antagonist, or the patient has undergone gastrectomy in cases of pernicious anemia, which we talk in detail later, or in various malabsorption states. Then B12 deficiency can also be seen in intestinal diseases. If there is some malignancy in the intestine, like lymphomas, there is ileal resection when the surface is not available for absorption, in worm infestation, especially in fish tapeworm. This fish tapeworm infestation is mainly seen in the Scandinavian countries along with USSR and Japan. What happens when this infestation is there, this fish tapeworm would fight with body and would compete with body for the B12. So B12 is less available for the body and it is taken away by the tapeworm. Then in pancreatic diseases, proteases would not be present and this B12 would not be dissociated from the R-binder protein and it would not be available to be absorbed, to be associated with intrinsic factor. Increased requirement is seen in hypermetabolic conditions, in pregnancy, during lactation, during hyperthyroidism, in various malignancies. And sometimes drugs, they interfere with the B12 absorption. These are mainly metformin, neomycin, para-aminosalicylic acid. Nitrous oxide is an important compound which can lead to inactivation of B12 and then it becomes inactive and it is not taking part in the reactions. Besides these deficiency states, we have certain hereditary disorders which can lead to B12 deficiency. Important is Imerslund-Grasbeck syndrome. It occurs due to recessive mutation in the tubulin gene, presented in infants or less than 2 years of age, along with features of B12 deficiency, proteinuria is also present. Then there can be deficiency of intrinsic factor due to recessive mutations in GIF gene. The difference from the first condition is proteinuria is not seen. And although rare, there can be genetic defects and inherited transcobalamin 2 deficiency. Folic deficiency is mostly seen due to poor intake. That can be seen in old age group due to poor socioeconomic conditions when the person is not having sufficient food, due to starvation, improper cooking, as I have already told. In chronic alcoholics, they are prone to develop folic deficiency. It is due to less intake of the calories because they are taking calories, empty calories in form of alcohol, not taking nutritious diet. And secondly, alcohol also impairs the metabolism and functions of the folic acid. So these two mechanisms operate and it is very commonly seen with chronic alcoholism. Then it can be due to poor absorption, due to gastrointestinal causes, due to general malabsorption conditions of the intestine like celiac disease, due to various malignancies or Crohn's disease. Then it can be demand, when demand is increased, either due to physiological causes or pathological hypermetabolic conditions. Then there are certain drugs which are antifolate, like methotrexate, trimethoprim, oral contraceptives, anticonvulsant drugs, which interfere with the utilization and metabolism of folic acid. After the deficiency, we will discuss the clinical features. Now, whenever we discuss the clinical features of anemias, the features can be pertaining to general deficiency of hemoglobin and the features which specifically pertain to specific conditions. General features include breathlessness, malaise, body aches, weight loss. Features pertaining specifically to B12 folic acid deficiency are, especially to B12 deficiency are, features resulting in cognitive dysfunctions, weight loss, abnormal skin pigmentation, either there is hyperpigmentation and patient is having yellow lemon color pigmentation due to presence of pallor and jaundice. Playing off here, there can be impotency, but this impotency is improved when B12 deficiency is improved. These patients, they have glossitis. In B12 deficiency, we have classical triad of megaloblastic anemia, neurological symptoms, and glossitis. Hyperpigmentation is due to increased production of the melanin. Neurological symptoms can be due to involvement of peripheral nerve. There can be paresthesias and loss of reflexes. There can be subacute combined degeneration of the spinal cord involving both sensory and motor functions. Earliest changes are they are seen in posterior columns. There is diminished vibration sensation and upper motor neuron signs they appear. Due to involvement of cerebrum, there is optic atrophy and dementia. Then there can be changes of autonomic neuropathy. Now coming to the most important aspect, that is lab diagnosis. Again, when we talk about lab diagnosis of anemias, first we have to suspect the anemias based on clinical symptoms and presentation of the patient. Then we investigate the patient. First are the general investigations, which will establish that patient is anemic, and then the type of anemia, whether this is microcytic, hypochromic, macrocytic, megaloblastic. After we have established this, then we will go on to the special test, that what is the exact cause of the deficiency. So these general tests, they include hemoglobin estimation, which is low, and its severity depends, how much hemoglobin is low, it depends on the severity of the anemia. In peripheral blood smear, earliest sign is presence of macrocytes, and these macrocytes, they are typically oval macrocytes, ovalocytes. Along with these ovalocytes, as these features evolve, there is more and more anisocytosis and poikilocytosis due to variation in shape and size. And we have nuclear remnants because of the features of dyserythropoiesis and ineffective erythropoiesis. These nuclear remnants, they are seen in the form of oval jolly bodies, basophilic stippling, and tappet rings. In leukocytes, another very characteristic feature is seen in the form of hypersegmented neutrophils. These patients, they present with mild to moderate degree of pancytopenia. Along with anemia, there can be leukopenia, there can be thrombocytopenia. This is due to ineffective hematopoiesis in the bone marrow. Giant platelets can be seen. Reticulocyte count is typically low, especially in untreated cases. So this is oval macrocytes. We see oval macrocytes like this. Along with this is hypersegmented neutrophil. This is a normoblast. Normoblasts, they are seen with megaloblastoid features, and they come due to extramedullary hematopoiesis, which is present in these cases. These are the Howell jolly bodies. This is the tappet ring, which is seen in these cases. This is basophilic stippling. Basophilic stippling, other than megaloblastic anemia, is also seen characteristically in lead poisoning. Hypersegmented neutrophils, they are characteristically seen in megaloblastic anemias, and they should be present more than 5% and with more than 5 lobes. When we perform the red cell indices, MCV is characteristically increased. If the MCV is more than 110, 115, we are sure that we are dealing with megaloblastic anemias. MCH is high, that is mean cell hemoglobin, but MCHC is either normal or low. On the basis of MCP, when we see in the histograms, these microcytic anemias, they are having shift to right, while the macrocytic anemias, they have shift to left. And this is how we see the counter report showing MCV more, MCH is also more, MCHC is within the normal range, RDW is also okay, hemoglobin is low. the best way to detect macrocytosis at an early age when we don't see the PBF changes is by the counter report. Coming to the bone marrow findings, we see characteristic findings in the bone marrow. Bone marrow is typically hypercellular. By the look of the bone marrow smears, we know that we are dealing with megaloblastic anemias. Bone marrow is packed. We are having large number of fragments, very cellular fragments. There is reversal of myeloid erythroid ratio because of the erythroid hyperplasia. Erythropoiesis is typically megaloblastic with predominance of early forms. There are features of ineffective erythropoiesis and dyserythropoiesis. Now, what do we mean by ineffective erythropoiesis? Since the marrow is cellular, there is so much of erythroid hyperplasia, but still we are having anemia. Because what happens, due to impaired DNA synthesis, most of the erythroid precursors, they die within the marrow. And only 10 to 15% of the precursors, they are maturing into macrocytes and coming to circulation, resulting into anemia. And because of this ineffective erythropoiesis, we are having features of hemolysis also. When we discuss about the characteristic features of megaloblast and we compare them with normoblast. So in comparison to normoblast, megaloblastoid cells, megaloblasts, they are larger than the corresponding normoblast. They have open sieve-like chromatin. They have lack of maturation. What do we think when we talk about maturation lag? Means cytoplasm and the nucleus are not maturing simultaneously. Here, the cytoplasmic maturing, it is acquiring hemoglobin, but nuclear maturation is lagging behind the cytoplasmic maturation. Even in the stage of orthochromatic normoblast, megaloblast, they have open nucleus, while in case of normoblast, they have shrunken nucleus, just a small shrunken nucleus. Here also still the cytoplasm acquired hemoglobin, but in case this is immature. And this is the comparison of the normoblast. These are the normoblasts and these are the megaloblasts. The same changes are seen in the granulocytic series and megakaryocytes. Because DNA impaired synthesis is seen in all the cells of the body, but it is predominantly manifested in the hematoid cells and in the erythroid cells and the granulocytic series. We see giant forms of metamyelocytes and megakaryocytes. They have hypersegmented nuclei. Bone marrow iron is increased due to non-utilization of the iron. This is how we see the giant metamyelocytes. When we perform the bone marrow trephine biopsy, the biopsy is packed with cells. This is how the appearance of the megaloblastic trephine biopsy. There is uniform population of large cells with open nucleus and prominent nuclei. What happens sometimes? There is confusion, there is misdiagnosis, and we have to differentiate these cells from the blast cells in cases of suspected myelodysplastic syndrome. When we do the special IHC stain, that is glycoforin, all these stains, they are cells, they are stained positive, confirming the erythroid nature of the cells. Another important point in differentiation from the myeloblast in the MDS is abnormal localization of the myeloblast. They follow the ALIP phenomena, that is abnormal localization of the immature precursors. They are seen in clusters, they are located at abnormal locations, while the megaloblast, they have the uniform distribution throughout the marrow. This is how the bone marrow iron is increased and how we see the bone marrow in the marrow fragments. Now, after we have done the PBF, hemoglobin, red cell indices, reticulocyte estimation, and bone marrow findings, we have certain biochemical investigations which are also abnormal in cases of myeloblastic anemias. Ferritin is more or less normal. Bilirubin is increased. Haptoglobins are low. LDH is also increased. So these three, they are indicative of hemolysis occurring along with the anemias. There are miscellaneous findings in the form of increased hemoglobin A2, decreased alkaline phosphatase, and less serum immunoglobulins. After we have done the routine investigations and we have established that this patient is having anemia and having megaloblastic features, now the next thing comes, what is the cause of the megaloblastic anemia? Whether this is due to deficiency of B12 or folic acid or due to some other causes. For that, we have to perform the special investigations. These special investigations, we have not single investigation which can point out definitely whether the patient is having B12 or folic acid deficiency. So we have to perform a series of investigation. In case of vitamin B12 deficiency, we do serum vitamin B12 assay and holotranscobalamin, which are the quantitative test. Although serum vitamin B12 is not very specific, but still this is the test which is done most commonly and in routine. Serum vitamin B12 assay can be done by two methods, microbiological assay and radioisotope assay. Microbiological assay, although considered gold standard, but nowadays we are not using it because it is cumbersome and results, they are affected by antibiotics. So radioisotope assay, which is more sensitive, rapid, we have commercial kits available. We are doing serum B12 assay by radioisotope method. Normal serum B12 levels are 182 640 nanograms per liter. Then nowadays we are estimating holotranscobalamin, which is the B12 which is bound to transcobalamin 2. This is the active fraction, this is the functional fraction, 10 to 20% of the vitamin B12 bound to transcobalamin 2, and we measure the concentrations. But this is not done in routine because many of the laboratories, they are not having this facility, so they are dependent on the serum vitamin B12 assay. Other more sensitive tests than the serum vitamin B12 is estimation of homocysteine and methylmalonic assay. They both are increased because they both are not being metabolized due to deficiency. They are more sensitive and early markers. They are increased before the onset of clinical symptoms. So they just indicate the negative states, stores are depleted and they become high. And they are also important in differential diagnosis of B12 and folic acid. Because we have already discussed, folic acid is only involved in the conversion of homocysteine to methionine. The other reaction, that is methylmalonic acid conversion to succinyl coenzyme A, is not being mediated by folic acid. So if the levels of both are increased, it means patient is having B12 deficiency. But if the homocysteine is increased and methylmalonic acid is normal, it means we are dealing with the folic acid deficiency. So serum MMA is the most sensitive and specific marker for B12 deficiency. Other than this, when we are monitoring the patient, we are giving therapy to the patient, these two are the markers which are sensitive for seeing the therapeutic response. Because estimation of B12 is not specific here, as B12 levels rise as soon as we give the vitamins. Because of the passive presence in the circulation of the therapeutic vitamin, the levels increase. While the levels of homocysteine and MMA will increase when the therapy is effective and body is responding to this therapy. So they are more sensitive than the B12 assay. So now if we talk about these two tests, we have the cobalamin reference interval of 150 to 670 picomoles per liter. If the levels are more than 250, it means patient is not deficient for B12. If the levels are less than 125, patient is surely deficient for B12. But if the levels are in between, this is the gray area, where we are not sure whether the B12 deficiency is there or not. Here we will perform the MMA test, methyl malonic acid estimation, which has a reference of 0.08 to 0.28 micromoles. Now, if the levels are less than 0.29, means they are not raised, it means patient is not deficient. If the levels are more than 0.75, levels are raised and we are sure of vitamin B12 deficiency. In case of gray area between these two levels, we will keep the patient on follow-up and we will keep repeating the test, and then we will come to the conclusion. We will see whether the levels are increasing, levels of B12 are decreasing, and so that way we will monitor the patient. Serum folic assay is done to estimate the folic acid deficiency, again by these two methods, but we prefer the radioisotope method. Serum folic, normal serum folic levels are 3 to 20 micrograms per liter. Red cell folic assay is also done, which is more sensitive than serum folic. Levels are 20 to 50 times more, because folic acid gets internalized within the cells during bone marrow maturation. It is a more reliable indicator because levels are not frequently changed and they remain more or less constant. Then we have a test specific for folic acid deficiency, that is the estimation of urinary excretion of Figlu. This Figlu, I have already told that this is an intermediary product in the catabolism of histidine. And when folic acid is deficient, this intermediary product would be collected and it would be excreted in increased amounts in the urine. So we can estimate that and we can be sure of folic acid deficiency. So just to summarize this test, if serum cobalamin is low, it is low in cobalamin deficiency, while in folic acid deficiency, it can be normal or even low. And this is a sensitive test, but not very specific. Serum folic can be normal or high in cobalamin deficiency, low in folic deficiency, and it is also having a good sensitivity. Red cell folate would also be low in cobalamin deficiency and it will be low in folate deficiency. So if we have this combination, normal serum folate and low red cell folate, it means we are dealing with cobalamin deficiency. But if we have low levels of both serum and red cell folate, it means we are dealing with folate deficiency. In case we are not sure of this, we will be performing serum methyl malonic acid estimation. It will be high and homocysteine, but normal in folate deficiency, while homocysteine would be high. So if we have this, this and this, we are sure of cobalamin deficiency. If we have this, red cell folate low, serum folate low, but homocysteine high, we are sure of folate acid deficiency. Now, once we have discussed the general aspects of megaloblastic anemia, I will talk about another important aspect of megaloblastic anemia, that is pernicious anemia. It is a special type of megaloblastic anemia which occurs due to lack of intrinsic factor. This intrinsic factor, it is secreted by parietal cells, and it is very, very important for the active absorption of B12 in the body by combining with B12 and then getting absorbed. This is an autoimmune disorder where the autoantibodies, they are formed against either intrinsic factor or parietal cells or proton pump, leads to destruction of the parietal cells, non-formation of intrinsic factor and pernicious anemia. These antibodies can be of two types, either the blocking antibody. Blocking antibodies will lead to non-formation of the complex of B12 and intrinsic factor. Other type of antibodies are binding antibodies, which will lead to non-formation of a complex of B12 intrinsic factor with the IL receptors, that is tubulin receptors. So in B12 deficiency, this intrinsic factor is not formed. Since it is not formed, vitamin B12 absorption would be defective. This is due to autoimmunity. There is chronic atrophic gastritis, deficiency of B12, these patients, they have increased risk of gastric malignancy and carcinoid tumor, along with pernicious anemia. Clinical presentation is with the features of anemia, glossitis, and especially neurological symptoms. Neurological symptoms are maximally seen with pernicious anemia than other forms of B12 deficiency. Most often, these patients, they are over the age of 30 years. Sometimes there is juvenile form in younger children. There is familial tendency, and this deficiency is most commonly seen in Northern Europe. And this is associated with autoimmune gastritis. In morphological findings, we have PBF and bone marrow changes of megaloblastic anemia. When we perform the gastric biopsy, there are changes of chronic atrophic gastritis. There is atrophy of fungal gland and intestinal metaplasia along with infiltration in lamina propria. CNS changes are typically seen. There is demyelination of dorsal and lateral spines, and there are features of subacute combined degeneration. For confirmation of pernicious anemia, along with other tests which we have already discussed, PBF, bone marrow, now we have to see the cause, whether this is due to deficiency or impaired absorption. We are suspecting pernicious anemia, we will confirm by doing test for absorption. We do the Schilling test, which is again a gold standard, although nowadays we are not performing this test because sometimes the radio label B12 is not available, and this test again is very cumbersome test, but we will discuss here because this is gold standard for doing the absorption testing. This test is performed in three stages. In stage one, we give 1 microgram of radio label B12 by oral route, which is followed by intramuscular injection of B12, and this gives B12, and we see the 24-hour, we do the 24-hour urine collection, and we see and we determine the level of radio label B12. Normally more than 10% should be excreted. If this is normal, it means there is deficiency of B12, and there is no deficiency, there is no problem at the absorption level. But if stage 1 is abnormal, we perform the stage 2. What we do in stage 2, we repeat the stage 1, but here with the radio label B12, we give the oral dose of intrinsic factor. Now, by giving intrinsic factor, if the test becomes normal, it will confirm the nature, it will confirm pernicious anemia, that the defect was at the level of intrinsic factor, which has now been corrected. But if stage 2 is also abnormal, it means problem is not at the level, and this is at the level of some intestinal malabsorption and some other causes than the pernicious anemia. Then we keep on repeating the test with one factor, then other factor. That way we come to the conclusion that where is the exact defect. Nowadays, we are doing the estimation of antibodies to the intrinsic factor. Both blocking and binding antibodies can be measured. Since more than 90% of the patients, they are having the antibodies and they come positive, they can be measured by the radioisotope method or by the ELISA. Recently, another test has been introduced, that is Cobasop test. This is the test in which we see for the levels of holotranscobalamin, that is the functional component of the B12. We give oral dose of vitamin B12 and we see the increasing level of holotrans. But this is not widely popular nowadays, till now, because most of the labs, they do not have this test, and we need special hematology lab for this. This is still under trial, and many of the labs, they are not using this test. Now we discuss certain other causes of megaloblastic anemia. Other than the cobalamin or folate deficiency, which directly impair the DNA synthesis. First is thymine responsive megaloblastic anemia. This is autosomal recessive disorder, which is characterized by diabetes mellitus, megaloblastic anemias, and hearing loss. This is due to mutations in the SLC19A2 gene. And these patients, they typically respond to thymine, but not to vitamin B12 or folic acid. Now, this megaloblastic anemia can be due to hereditary orotic aciduria. This condition is characterized by developmental abnormalities, presence of orotic acid crystals, and other urethral problems. And this is due to defect in the gene involved in the synthesis of UDMP. Then we have miscellaneous causes. This megaloblastic anemia can be due to various chemotherapeutic agents like hydroxyurea. It can be seen in association with myelodysplastic syndromes and sometimes in congenital dyserythropoietic anemias, erythroleukemias, or other types of acute myeloid leukemias. Now coming to management. Management of vitamin B12 and folic acid deficiency is very, very important, because management does not include only treating the and giving the patient vitamin, either B12 or folic acid. Management is to give the vitamin, to see the response, to monitor the doses, to decide which route is preferred, and then to see the response, how the therapy is responding. And very, very important, especially in case of pernicious anemia, is counseling of the patient, because these patients, they have to take lifelong treatment. Most important is we have to establish the cause and then treat accordingly. In severe cases, if the hemoglobin is very low and we have not performed the test and we are not sure whether the patient is having B12 or folic acid deficiency, we will give the therapeutic trials of both the vitamins. But very, very important is, before we start with the therapy, we should take all the samples, because this megaloblastic erythropoiesis, it comes to normoblastic erythropoiesis within 24 hours. So if we have started the therapy, have not taken the samples, have not performed the bone marrow, we might miss the diagnosis, because we will see the normoblastic erythropoiesis. And in case, another very, very important factor is, if we are not sure that if the patient is having folic acid or B12 deficiency, we have to give both. Because if we treat the patient only with folic acid and if he comes B12 deficient, although it will improve anemia a little bit, but it will worsen the neurological symptoms. So unless we are sure, we are giving both the therapies to the patient. Aim of the B12 treatment is correction of hematocrit, and very importantly, to improve the neurological symptoms and to restore the storage pools. In routine, we give 1000 micrograms of hydroxycobalamin by intramuscular route for 7 to 10 days. In this duration, most of the features, they revert back. We will discuss about that in the next slide. And after that, we give maintenance doses every 3 months. Nowadays, oral therapy is also being tried, that is also effective. But the problems with oral therapy is we have to give it daily in large pharmacological doses, in which the patient compliance may be poor and it is difficult to manage or to check whether the patient is taking or not, and therapeutic response is also not consistently monitored. Usually, we do not need the blood transfusion unless the hemoglobin is very low and there is associated cardiovascular abnormalities or other problems. Only then we have to give the blood transfusion. That also preferably we give PCB. Response to treatment is estimated. Reticulocyte count, they start increasing by third day. Peak levels come on 6 to 7 days, and they generally come to the normal levels by third week. Erythropoiesis, it becomes normoblastic within first 24 hours. So we have to keep this point in mind, and we have to perform the bone marrow before starting with therapy. Hematocrit normalizes in a month or two, and hypersegmented neutrophils, they also fall down in 2 weeks' time. So for monitoring response, we check the reticulocyte count after 1 week. We check the homocysteine and methionine levels. As I have already discussed, that these are more sensitive markers for therapeutic response. B12 is not a good marker to see the therapeutic response. Response is completed usually within 8 weeks. So if after 8 weeks response is not complete, it means we have coexistent iron deficiency. And this iron deficiency does not manifest unless the megaloblastic anemia is treated. So after we are treating the patient for 2 to 3 weeks, then if there is iron deficiency, we will have manifestations of that also, and the response would be incomplete. So we have to keep this thing in mind, that we are dealing with a combined deficiency. Or very important thing is, our diagnosis may not be correct. Patient may not be having B12 deficiency. So giving B12 would not help. Neurological symptoms, they improve within 6 months. Sometimes it takes 1 year to improve. But if after 1 year there is no improvement, again, we have to suspect our diagnosis, which may not be correct. Sometimes, usually the therapy is safe, there is not much complication, but sometimes we deal with increased platelets and we have to take care of that. And in patients in which the potassium is already at the borderline, a patient may develop sudden hypokalemia. Treatment of folic acid is relatively simple. Folic acid is given 1 to 2 milligrams per day, and stores, they are usually repeated in a month or two. Here, before we pass on to the next thing, I would like to tell that if we are dealing with pernicious anemia, this is very important to monitor the patient. It is not only the therapy which is given. We have to monitor the patient, we have to counsel the patient, and we have to see, and we really have to be careful for development of malignancy, because these patients' chances of developing gastric carcinoma and carcinoid, they are 3 times more than the normal patient. And early signs of development of malignancy, they have to be taken care of. If there is sudden loss of weight, appetite, and there is sudden worsening of anemia, we have to keep this thing in mind. Why there may be sudden worsening of anemia? Because in cases of malignancy, there may be hemolysis and loss of blood which result into anemia. So we have to keep these things in mind, and counseling is very important, because these patients, they need to take treatment lifelong, so they need to be counseled. In certain cases, we have to give prophylaxis. B12 prophylaxis is given to infants in which the mother is already having pernicious anemia, or if the patient has undergone total gastrectomy, and if the patient is strictly vegetarian for a long time. Folic acid prophylaxis is given in women who are planning for pregnancy to prevent neural tube defects. We start and or sometimes before the pregnancy. It is given to pregnant and lactating mothers in various hemoglobinopathies, hypermetabolic conditions, and methotrexate therapy. Now, we have discussed everything. We have discussed the diagnosis. We have discussed the management. Now, I'll just summarize the important tests, what is their diagnostic importance, and how they will help to exclude the other conditions, and what is the pitfall. First of all, in blood film, if we see oval macrocytes, hypersegmented neutrophils, and various nuclear remnants, they are suggestive of megaloblastic anemias, cobalamin, or folate deficiency. And all these features, they will help to exclude myelodysplastic syndrome, in which we have overt features of dysplasia. And other causes of macrocytic anemias like alcoholism, liver disorder, where we will not see the oval macrocytes, we will see target cells, we will see round macrocytes. But here the sometimes pitfall is, sometimes hypersegmented neutrophils, they can be seen due to other conditions also. So just on the basis of hypersegmented neutrophils, we cannot diagnose. And other feature is mild dyserythropoietic features, they are also seen in megaloblastic anemia. So we actually have to weigh all the features in totality for the diagnosis. reticulocyte count, it is low, especially when the treatment is not given. And if we give the treatment and reticulocyte response comes, it will confirm the diagnosis B12 or folic acid. But here the catch is, sometimes this response may be blunted, because if we have coexisting iron deficiency, response would not be proper and then this would not be increased. In bone marrow, if the megaloblastic erythropoiesis is there, we see giant metamyelocytes, we don't see ring sideroblast. It will help us to exclude myelodysplastic syndrome. It will help us to exclude aplastic anemia, where we see the fatty marrow, not the cellular marrow, and no hematopoietic cells. But sometimes we do not appreciate the megaloblastic change only due to B12 or folic acid deficiency. I have already told that megaloblastic change can be seen in various other conditions. So just on the basis of megaloblastic erythropoiesis, we cannot make the diagnosis. It can be drug induced, it can be due to dyserythropoietic anemias, myelodysplastic syndrome. Now coming to the serum test, if serum B12 is less than 180, it will be suggestive of cobalamin deficiency. But if the levels are low, but there are no clinical signs and symptoms and no neurological deficit and normal homocysteine levels, it will confirm that there are B12 levels, they are falsely low, and it may be folate deficiency. So we will give the folic acid and we will monitor the B12 levels. Just opposite to this, if the levels are normal but clinical signs and symptoms are present, features of neuropathy are there, so we will give a therapeutic trial and we will perform the additional test, MMA or homocysteine, if possible. If these two are increased, it means we are treating with B12 deficiency, even if the serum B12 is not exactly deficient. We will monitor the response. We will see for the levels of these two metabolites. If they fall down, it means our diagnosis is confirmed. Serum folate, they are low, especially along with red cell folate. They will indicate folic acid deficiency. But if only red cell folate are low, serum folate are normal, it means we are dealing with the cobalamin deficiency. Schilling test, when we perform part 1 normal, it means deficiency. Part 1 abnormal, part 2 normal, it means we are dealing with deficiency at the level of intrinsic factor. If part 1 and 2 are abnormal, but part 3 is normal, it means we are dealing with the other causes of deficiency. But here also, pitfall is, this test becomes invalid in case of chronic renal failure because there is defective excretion. And sometimes, even if pernicious anemia is present, this part 2 might not be corrected, because if the antibody levels are high, this part 2 would not correct. So this was in nutshell how we do the investigation, how we interpret, and what should be we taking care while doing the interpretation. In the end, I'll just share a flow diagram which will tell us how to approach these patients of macrocytic anemias. So if the hemoglobin is low, PBF shows macrocytosis. We do the PBF examination, macrovellocytes if present, hypersegmented neutrophils are present. We have seen the bone marrow, which shows megaloblastic erythropoiesis. If all these features are present, means patient is having megaloblastic anemia. If these features are not present, it means there is non-megaloblastic macrocytic anemia. In case of megaloblastic anemia, now we will pass on to the special test to confirm what is the specific deficiency. If the serum B12 is low, holotranscobalamin is low, and methylmalonic acid high, homocysteine high, means we are dealing with vitamin B12 deficiency. If serum folate is low, red cell folate also low, and FIGLU is high, means we are dealing with folic acid deficiency. But if serum levels are normal, homocysteine and methylmalonic acid both are high, it means we are dealing with some inherited disorder of DNA synthesis, or it may be drug induced, or it may be even B12, where the serum B12 has not manifested. in case of non-megaloblastic macrocytic anemia, we will do the reticulocyte count. If this is increased, means there may be possibility of hemolytic anemia. If the reticulocyte count is normal or decreased, we have to rule out other causes like alcoholism, hyperthyroid, and we have discussed all these causes, myelodysplastic syndrome, dyserythropoietic anemias, and others. With this, I think I have tried to cover all the aspects of the megaloblastic anemia. I'll be taking up the questions if there are any.
Thank you. Excellent presentation, ma'am. And
there was some disturbance.
No, ma'am, that's not in your control. I mean, these are part of the game. I mean,
although I had kept two connections, but somehow I couldn't do it. Sorry for that.
I'm ready to take the questions,
if any.
Yeah, before the questions, let me just share with you some of the comments, which I think would clearly, you know, tell you exactly how it went. Dr. Renuka Verma says, thank you, ma'am, for teaching us this important topic in such a simple manner, carrying lots and lots of information and basic approach to an anemic patient. Absolutely, she is spot on. You have spoken so well, simplified the whole topic, covered almost everything. I mean, I think there was nothing left to cover. And wonderful and extremely well done, ma'am. Excellent presentation. Dr. Zaini Charan says, thank you, ma'am. Let me see if there are any questions on the YouTube, or anybody would like to ask any question who are in the Google Meet. They can unmute and ask, ma'am, straight away. Dr. Anku Alisha says, thank you, ma'am. Khushbu Arora says, thank you, ma'am. I don't think so there are any questions, because it was so well explained, every bit of it, and especially the last five slides, you know, that was the topping on the cake, because it is trying to put everything in perspective. I mean, and especially the algorithm which you put up in the end clarifies everything very clearly, very nicely presented, ma'am. I think you must have really worked hard in trying to put this
kind words. Very generous of you to say like this. Thank
no,
you
ma'am,
so
no, no, generous. That's a true opinion. I mean, this is going to be because you know we have a system of recording all this, and this is up on the YouTube. It will be there forever. And I would request you to share the PDF, because we have a Google Drive dedicated where we upload all the PDF of all the lectures. And for your information, your lecture is lecture number 2207.
Okay,
so we have already had 206 lectures. So, right. Let me see if there are any questions left. Dr. Chandrasekhar says, thank you, ma'am. So, exactly, it was a very nice presentation, ma'am. Thank you so much. I would request you to come back again on this platform with something more.
I will keep in touch with you
on WhatsApp.
Yes.
And Dr. Anita Tehlan had very high words and regards for you. And you have really done
She's a close friend also. She's my friend.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anita.
Thank you, ma'am. Take care.
Yes.
Good night. Take care. Bye-bye, everybody. Bye. Take care. Bye. Thank you so much, ma'am. Bye.